welcome. With this video, we will discuss how we can describe wind conditions. And by that, we will discuss statistical distributions of Weibull and Rayleigh. Quite often we are confronted with the question, is it enough when we know the mean velocity of a certain site for the wind speeds? And the question, when I ask this question, is clear, it is no. Because due to this fact that we have the power depends on the wind velocity to the free, we make a big error when we just calculate with the mean wind speed. And therefore, we need to consider really with the complete distribution of all the wind speeds. When we have a look to a typical wind measurement, here we have the wind speeds over time. Then we typically observe that sometimes we have very high wind speeds, sometimes very low wind speeds, very few times even a calm, and everything in between. And that is difficult just to tell, oh, how wind behavior really is. So what we are doing is we sort all those measurement data in a way that we do not have anymore on the horizontal axis this time, but now the wind velocity classes. That means we are just looking, for example, here, how often do we have wind speeds between 0 and 1 meter per second? And that in this case is 2% of all wind measurement data. Then we look, what do we have between 1 and 2 meter per second? And then we see, oh, 4% of the wind measurement data is there. And then we result in a curve that we are trying to fit with a mathematical expression that is fitting those green bars. And that is typically a Weibull approach, it's a Weibull distribution. Accidentally, we almost for all sites worldwide find the Weibull distribution function that quite well covers the information of the behavior of our wind speed at a certain site. Not completely perfect. So we see here, for example, here we are overestimating the green bars. Here maybe we are underestimating the green bars a bit, but it is very close to the reality and much more comfortable calculating with a statistical distribution than with 10,000 of measurement values all the time. And therefore, we have a look to this Weibull distribution. And when we have a look to a maths book, then we find Weibull distribution. All statistical distributions have two characteristic curves. And the first, that would be the cumulative frequency. And there we find the expression f of x is equivalent to 1 minus the exponential function to the minus of x minus x0 divided by x63 minus x0, and that to a delta. That's quite complex, and we will soon see that for wind behavior it is much easier. I have here this picture of a high voltage mast, and that was the first time when I as a student was confronted with Weibull distribution, when we as students needed to make measurements on these isolators. That is a quite complex task or complex component, because we have here this lattice mast connected here, and that is on the ground. That means that has earth potential. And then we have here the high voltage power line that is maybe in this case 220 kilovolt. So enormous difference, and the task of the isolator is to isolate the earth potential from the 220,000 volts. And when we do measurements, every measurement gives a different result. So the breakthrough voltage, when it's getting not any more isolating, is in every measurement a different value. And when we observe all the measurements, it also behaves like a Weibull function. But all measurements have in common that up to a certain voltage, we never have a breakthrough. And that is the so-called here, this x0. And when we now go back to wind, we can say that this x0 for wind, that is always 0 meters per second, because the, even the best places in the world for wind, sometimes we have a calm, sometimes the wind speed is 0. So we can forget for wind power about those x0s. And when we have a look to wind books, there we find then the Weibull function f of v, not anymore of x, because it's now the wind velocity we would like to describe. And that is then also 1 minus the exponential function to the minus, then the x is getting the v, and we are not writing any more x63, but a big a, and the delta quite often is becoming a k or sometimes also a c. And what we are getting then is we have v is the velocity of the wind, that is in meters per second. Then we have this factor a, that is the scaling factor. And that also has the dimension of meter per second. And then finally we have this k, and that is the form parameter. And that does not have a dimension. By the way, this form parameter k, now we leave that for a different place, but when we then display here our cumulative frequency curve f of v, and here we have v, then we have a certain point where we have the 100%, and then the typical form is something like that. And then we have somewhere this 63%, and when we have 63%, then the wind speed here in a Weibull function is just a meter per second. That is why in the maths book we find here quite often this x63, where in wind technology we talk about the scaling factor. The second characteristic curve we have, that is the density function. The density function is just then h of v, and that is the derivative of the cumulative frequency. That is v, f of v, and then we get here the result, that is k divided by a times v divided by a to the k minus 1 times the exponential function v divided by a to the k. So that is a bit more complex, and when we plot the function, we get here a typical curve that we have seen in the first slides for the density function. When we plot that a bit more comfortable here, we see here a Weibull distribution function, here the density function, 3 different ones, but all have in common that they have a scaling factor of 8 meters per second and different form parameters. So when we have a small form parameter of 1.7, then typically the maximum is lower, and all the wind speeds are distributed a bit more to the left, but we also see then sometimes we have quite high wind speeds also. And when we have more higher values for k, then we see we have a quite high maximum that is a bit more to the right, but high wind speeds are not occurring very often. When we see one more the cumulative frequency, then we see that they have all one in common, and that is this 63% value that they always cross here exactly in the same point. But the distribution is then different according to the form parameters. The question is now, when we have that problem that we only know the mean wind speed, and people are asking, how much will the wind turbine produce, or is it worth installing a wind turbine in this place? The good, really honest answer would be, I can't tell you. Please tell me the Weibull parameters A and K. But almost nobody will say, Weibull parameters A and K are this and this. So the only thing quite often is known is the mean wind velocity. And the worst one could do would be just calculating with the mean wind velocity. And therefore, when we do not know more, we just calculate with a Weibull distribution function where k is equal to 2.0. And when k is equal to 2.0, then we get a Rayleigh distribution. And the Rayleigh distribution then is the cumulative frequency is 1 minus the exponential function minus v divided by a to the square, because k now is 2. And we have the density function that is then just 2 times the velocity divided by a to the square times the exponential function to the minus v divided by a to the 2. And the good thing is that now for a Rayleigh distribution, we know a relation between this scaling factor A and the mean wind velocity. And that is that we have A is equivalent to the mean wind velocity times 2 divided by P, and there the square root of P. And with that, we get a relation from this quite often known mean wind speed to a distribution function, in this case, the Rayleigh function. When we just discuss wind behavior, we also should discuss about turbulences. And turbulent behavior is very typical for winds. When you remember, we just have had here the wind velocities over time, and the typical behavior is something like this here. And when we, for example, just have a look only to this part here and have a very close look, even to seconds or parts of a second, we always see that the real behavior is more something like that. And that we call the wind is turbulent. And in order to express the turbulence, we use the turbulence intensity. And the turbulence intensity of the velocities, that is defined as sigma of the velocity, or the standard deviation of the velocity, divided by the mean wind velocity. Whereas the standard deviation, the sigma of v, that is just 1 divided by the time period we are considering for the calculation, times the integral from 0 to t, times the velocity of all the measurements minus the mean wind velocity to the square over this time, and then here the square root. And typically for wind measurements, we take time spans of 10 minutes. So when we are finishing this consideration, what would happen when we are calculating just with the mean wind velocity? So we never should do it, but when we do it, we have a worst case consideration. That means our calculation on the energy yield is always the worst we could calculate, because all those deviations between the mean wind velocity, those who are higher above the mean wind velocity count more due to this behavior to the velocity to the free, then we have minor power or energy yields when we are below the average of the mean wind speed. And therefore, I would like to conclude now. And in the next video, we will have a look how the wind speeds are changing with the height above ground. So thank you very much.